will. You know him by his little itty-bitty picture if you read the Tampa Bay Times, and you appreciate the fact that he has been on the staff of the Times for 25 years now. That's fabulous. Now, here's what's kind of fun. He is connected to Gail through the fact that when he was writing for the Gainesville Sun, he was writing an article about Gail's pioneering debut as an NFL calling the game, and she was the first woman to do it, and he remembers like it was yesterday because he printed it when she said, "Touchdown, Herman Herb." Yes, with Kansas City, in case you didn't know and weren't following closely. He grew up in Tallahassee, the son of professors, and really, you'll get to hear so much more about them, particularly his mother. In 2012, his life shifted with the Times because he became bureau chief and in charge of the whole regional outfit. And of course, we love his columns and his personality and his joy of life and his ability to capture people's lives and nonprofit organizations and events in our county is rich, and we're grateful to you for that. Thank you so much. One thing about him, too, is that one day someone said to him, you must be really good at writing to be, you know, having done this all these years and all these different cities and papers in Leesburg and Gainesville and now in Tampa. And he said, "No, I'm just really bad at math." Ernest, I'd like to ask you the same question. What is the one characteristic you most admire in the woman that you choose to speak about, and how did that influence you?
Well, I choose to speak about my late mom, Ann Hooper. And I would sum it up with the word fairness. And she influenced me to be fair in how I treat others. And she really helped me develop my moral compass. My mom had many reasons to consider herself to be an elite. She grew up in Atlanta as part of what was known as the Black Elite. Her father, my grandfather, was a very prominent dentist in Atlanta. They were friends with the King family. They were in this social circle of very successful African Americans. But my mom was always a rebel, and while her older sisters went to the prestigious Spelman College in Atlanta, she went for a year, and then she transferred to a smaller school in Alabama because she didn't see herself as part of that elite. And never was that sense of fairness, that sense of justice, more evident than in 1970. My mom and dad were professors at Florida A&M, and they lived in a neighborhood that had been designated for African Americans in Tallahassee. They had moved into their home in 1958, the year they got married. And the streets in the neighborhood were named to appeal to African Americans. We lived on Basin Street. The next street over was Calloway Street, after Cab Calloway. The third street was Joe Lewis. The fourth street was Harlow. So, nice neighborhood, cinder block homes, middle class neighborhood. And across from our home and the other homes on the west side of Mason Street was a huge wooded lot. So in 1970, the federal government decided to build a housing project in this huge wooded lot. And my mother and father's friends at Florida A&M asked them, "When are you moving?" They didn't ask, "Are you moving?" They asked, "When are you moving?" Because they couldn't fathom that the Hoopers, the intelligent collegiate professors, would live across the street from a housing project. And my mom just said, "Well, why would we move? I love my home. I don't want to move anywhere." And in that, she taught us that people just like us. And the sons who lived across the street became my friends. The daughters became our babysitters. The parents became our friends. And never once did my mother look down on them or think poorly of them. She always treated them with respect and kindness. And even through the years, as the neighborhood had changed and some crime problems arose, my mom continued to live there. And while there was crime in the neighborhood, my mother was never victimized. And I always felt like it was because she treated everyone with respect. And people would come over and help her take the groceries in the house. And some of her friends would say, "Aren't you afraid to allow those people in the house?" And she'd say, "Why? Why would I be afraid?" And so she lived there to the end of her life. They called her Dr. Who. the minister at her funeral so eloquently explained, she was a PhD in the hood. And I think I've always admired that. That has shaped a lot of how I approach my columns and the sense of justice, the sense of fairness that I try to incorporate. And just one of many lessons I've learned.
Why don't we bring it back through that way? And Ernest, I'm going to ask you, how do you carry the lessons that you learned from your mother into your everyday life?
Well, first and foremost, I have three kids of my own, and I'm always trying to instill in them a sense of fairness. And what I learned from my mother about treating everyone with respect, regardless of a real walk in life. And I'm really thrilled to say that when my son was in high school, I remember looking in the living room one day, and he was sitting there with his friends watching television, and there was a Jewish guy, a Christian guy, a guy from Palestine, a guy who grew up in Azerbaijan, Black guy. My living room looked like the United Nations. to me, I just felt like, we talk so much about race relations and where we are as a nation, but in him and in his group of friends, I saw only hope. And I really feel like this next generation, if they can continue what I saw in my living room that night, we're going to be fine. We're going to be okay. And I take a lot of pride in that. With his mom, of course, if she was here, she would tell me she deserves all the credit. I take a lot of pride in the fact that we've been able to instill in our kids that sense of acceptance and inclusion. And I see them modeling it every day. I see my middle son, who's a student at the University of Central Florida, going to rallies to show support for his fellow students who happen to be immigrants. And he's not an immigrant, but he wants to show them that he cares. So all of that I trace back to my mom. In addition to instilling that in me, my mom always had a welcoming home, and we often hosted exchange students from foreign countries, from France, from Senegal, from Spain. And my mom always saw those as cultural opportunities. So I inherited all from her. I also inherited my lack of height from her. That's okay. Yes. She was 4'11".
Ernest, I'm going to ask you, what is the best lesson that your mother instilled in you?
Well, first of all, let me say this. I heard Mike tell that story before. Mike's mom didn't measure things out when she made pies, which I thought was remarkable. We had to watch it, but she just did the stupidest and smashing that. You know, there was no, you know, when I try to do something, I have to have very specific instructions. You know, my mom instilled in me a lot of lessons, and I think what I most appreciate about my mom, of the many things, is, you know, she always kind of knew what to say. She knew when to be stern, and she knew when to be gentle. When I got in trouble in first grade, and they called mom down to the school, I said, "Mom, the teacher doesn't like me." She said, "Don't have me come down to the school again." I'm not coming down here. "Yeah, but she doesn't like me." "I don't care if she doesn't like you. If I have to come down to the school again, you're gonna be in trouble." That was the time to be stern. When I was at the University of Florida, and I got a D in a class. I thought she would be stern again, but she was actually gentle and reassured me that I was going to be okay. It actually kind of scared me, you know. this costume is for real. My mom's not yelling at me. I guess it is possible for me to flunk out. I think she's worried. But, so she always kind of knew it, and with my siblings also, she always knew the right buttons to push. She was skilled at that. And I love my dad, but my dad was just a yeller. You know, my dad just, you know, every solution was to get mad and yell at me. And I didn't quite understand it. He was a devout Catholic, but cursed like a sailor. So that was kind of his one car. But my mom, especially with my sisters, she kind of always knew when to calm them down, when to push them, when to cajole them. And so I tried to take the same approach with my kids. And I remember my oldest son got in trouble once. And we were riding in the car, and I had to pick him up from a convention in Orlando. He was at a high school convention, and he got in trouble, and they sent him home. He said, "Well, aren't you going to yell at me?" And I thought about my mom. I said, "No, son, I'm just very disappointed." Crushed it. Absolutely disappointed. Hang on, I'm one of them sinners. You know, so the parenting is something that I think I learned from my mom. Well, we've been speaking of my mom, and in 2000, my mom was diagnosed with lung cancer, and went through all the chemotherapy and radiation, and began to recover in 2001, and we really thought, at least we were hoping, she won her battle with cancer. In hindsight, I think she may have just been holding on for a special moment, because in 2002, my grandmother, her mother, turned 100 years old. And my mom threw all of her energy into planning this huge party for my grandmother. That was in January of 2002. And my grandmother, just, you know, another 30-minute story, but was very well known in Atlanta. And so we had dignitaries come, the mayor came, all of her friends came. It was just this huge hotel ballroom, gala, if you will. And then shortly after that, the cancer came back. And I remember going up in April and welcoming hospice into her home. She had come to the realization that she was facing her final days, and wanted to be in that house that she had lived in since 1958. she had refused to give up despite everything that changed in the neighborhood. And hospice came in, put her in a comfortable place. I was there. And then next morning, I found her and she had passed away. And I think she just needed hospice to bring, to put her in that place of comfort, to put her in that place of care. And so after I found her, I called hospice. And one of the nurses came and was very calm, very reassuring. And I think it kind of infused that in me. She was so calm, she was so reassuring that I grew calm. And I started thinking about the different things we needed to do. And my younger sister was also there. And so after the nurse left the hospice, it was like 6:30 in the morning, the funeral home had come and taken my mother away. And at 6:30 in the morning, I'll never forget, I started cleaning out the refrigerator. Because I knew my neighbors would be bringing, you know, when you lose someone, the neighbors bring like food for days. I said, we gotta clean out the refrigerator. My sister just kind of looked at me. She's like, are you okay? I said, no, I'm fine. Like, this is what I need to do. And because of the calm that hospice gifted me with, you know, I was able to stay focused and do the things necessary to arrange for my mom's funeral and do all those necessary things. So I have to imagine those are the kind of gifts that hospice gives to families every day. And that's why your support is so important, because even if you're not there, you're helping people deal with those difficult moments in a positive way and in a healthy way. And what I really appreciate about hospice is that you guys also help in the weeks and months to come. Because that's when it grows more difficult. In those first few days, that first week, you find a way to busy yourself. But it's in those months that come that are grief. So yes, very, very grateful.